Boss, I not like this?
Can we not?
Yes, boss.
Yes, boss. Colton. Colton. Hit. Hit. Colton. Gladiator, ready.
Ready.
Ready. Sim, you will go on my first whistle. Assad, you will go on my second whistle. Hello and welcome to Reminding You Why You Love Football. And here is the best review we have ever had from EBPS, which sounds like a postage firm. If you selfishly moved to Australia about 10 years ago, lost touch with football because it all got a bit too Gary Neville, my guy, EBPS, not Gary Neville, and miss your mates, listening to this will make you miss them more, but also somehow feel closer to home and the football you love, all of it. Ideal for footballing and cultural references if you're a bit older than the Goblin and the Gooser.
Yes!
Wait, you wait.
Great name for a pub.
Great name for a pub. But not as good as this, maybe. And a bit younger than Tank Man and the Benevolent Dictator.
Yeah, fair enough.
If... All the way from Australia.
He's the Secretary General. Not
all the way from Australia. Thanks, lad, it signs off. If this is your first episode, those nicknames will make no sense, but I'm your host and benevolent dictator, Alf Stewart, and joining me are Assad Flaming Galah Raza, Tommy the Dag Stewart, and Seb Drongo White.
Oh, yeah.
G'day, mate.
I love it.
Let's chuck another shrimp on the barbie.
My name isn't actually Alf Stewart. It's Owen Blackhurst, and I'm your host, and we are 4.9 on Apple, 5-star on Spotify, fucking 10 stars wherever else you want it.
Wow, are we? Right?
Yeah.
All the stars. We're all those things.
We
are a football podcast who toots its own horn. Blows its own trumpet.
Yeah.
As great fun doing so, as enjoying this very much. And we hope you enjoy it, whether it's your first time, your 39th time, and hopefully not your last. Hit it, Same. Seb.
Here, here.
Oh.
Hit it, Seb.
Oh, we've...
Oh. Got another one who just can't let the fucking air settle, have we? So what you've done there is just repeat me like... fucking Phil Neal to Graham Taylor.
Oh no.
Yes, boss.
Can we not?
Do
boss,
I not like
boss,
this?
Can we not?
Yes, boss.
Yes, boss. Can we not? Colton. Colton. Hit. Colton. Hit Les.
I'm going to lose my job for this.
Can we not? Can we not? Yes, you will, Assad. Yes, you will. Keep your mouth shut. Just let the air settle at times. Just a little bit of. Nothing wrong with that. Nothing wrong with that. Adventures in Clubland. Now, fighting is not big, it is not hard, and it is not clever. It is not fun. If you ever had your head kicked in, you will know it is not fun. I've been hit over the head with a fire poker and still have the scar to remind me of it in the back of my head.
Obviously.
That wasn't fun. All I was doing was talking to my ex-girlfriend. It's a long and boring story, which I went...
Yes, people are going to want to know.
It was my first night out after a knee reconstruction. I'd spent a lot of time on my own over the previous 8 or 9 months, smoking weed, listening to The Strokes and Dr. Dre, playing Football Manager and reading my... And it was fucking miserable.
On paper, it sounds close.
I moved back into my mum's. All of it crap. And my knee was like, fucking someone to take a chainsaw to it. But first night out, I was walking back from town to go up to my mate's house for a small afters, and I bumped into my ex-girlfriend, who I hadn't seen since we split up. We were just having a bit of a chat outside the shop, and these group of people came round the corner, and I instantly recognised them as Telford. They weren't from Bridge North, and I was like... No, Tommy, you'll know what I mean. Like,
I know.
I said to my ex-girlfriend, I said, run. And she went, and... They came round and I thought, oh God, they were carrying stuff. And I was like,
oh no.
Yeah. So I tried to leg it, but I couldn't really leg it because my fucking, not with the knee, know what I mean? And I sort of, next thing I know, I came to in the living room of a house I sort of half recognised, covered in fucking blood, and loads of my mates there. And I was like, what the fucking hell happened? And the bloke was like, oh, it's not swearing, the kids are upstairs. And I was like, I didn't know what the fuck was going on. Obviously, concussed the fuck.
Yeah, yeah. Oh my God.
Dummy over the head with a fire poker. But luckily, some of my mates had heard it, ran back down the hill, and at that point, they were dragging a paving slab over which they were going to.
Oh my God!
I know, yeah. But then after that, the reason I would, they just used me as a warm up there on to do some real damage to some fella. They gouged someone's eye out with that fucking fire poker.
Oh, fuck me.
It was bloody hell.
It was like the half brother of this bloke who lived in marijuana mansions down the bottom by the school.
Marijuana Mansions.
Not his real name.
Marijuana Mansions, yeah.
Unless they do things really differently.
So for one time in my life, I hadn't deserved this, and the nurse, finally, when I finally got to hospital, just thought I was some dickhead who'd been out scrapping.
Of course,
she really
yeah.
crudely stitched the back of my head up, and I've got like a...
Ah, oh, not a crude stitch-up.
A crude stitch-up. It's like a... It's like a reverse Harry Potter on the back of the head. Oh. The mark of Satan, really. Is. And, but every now and again, I go, oh, and I can, it like, I don't know.
Oh, God.
PTSD.
Oh,
God.
Yeah. I'll drop down dead from it one day. Anyway, moving on. Fighting isn't big or hard or clever.
Not there, for sure.
And talking about soccer's hard men can often be a bit derivative, but we're going to do this anyway because we wanted a different type of adventure in Clubland today. And we have found our bouncer. This is the man who is going to stand on the door of the Adventures in Clubland Club, the Mundial Clubhouse, and will not be letting one in. And it's not your Ruddocks, it's not Norman Hunter, it's not anyone like that. It is Big Bad Billy Whitehurst. Now, I'll give you the headline stuff. Big Bad Billy Whitehurst. The adventure is the first 5 years of his career as a pro at Hull City. But really, we're talking about everywhere because there's so much anecdotal stuff about his career that it's irresistible. Now, if he ended anyone's career badly, I'm not sure. Like, if he did anyone, and like, I'm not glorifying it. And people can come out and say, like, I don't know. Do you know what I mean? So hands up. But once I started reading it, he came off a building site and made the grade. He'd struggled to get into pro football. And in his third season, he started to score a lot of goals. He had a 20-goal season and Hull got promoted from the third division. And he's a hero at Hull City. There's a song by a band called...
The Candy Twins, Big Billy.
Bad Billy. And it's like, at first he was fucking crap and stuff like this. Anyway, and I know we love a YouTube comment, but this is unreal. I won't say the name of this person. There's a comment further on down which has one like... My granny was mad at me for hooking up with Billy. R.I.P. granny.
That is an incredible...
Power.
Oh, my goodness.
He had a good time of it at Hull. And then he went to loads of fucking places. He went to Newcastle and he played there with Gazza and Chris Waddle. Didn't quite work out. And he went here, there and everywhere. And when he was at Sheffield United, him and Vinnie Jones used to go out to pubs and basically wait for Sheffield Wednesday fans to come in. And Billy had done just clear the pub.
Oh, my God.
Wow.
Yeah, I think there was one quote, Vinnie Jones said, the best punch he's ever seen thrown in or outside a boxing ring was from Billy White.
And he would have seen some,
and he would have seen some punches. And I remember his name, and I do remember this. I remember Alan Shearer saying to Lineker on Match of the Day, do you remember Billy Whitehurst? And Lineker went, oh, my God, Billy Whitehurst was evil. Alan Hansen, not a Rolls Royce. We've decided we won't see that. Alan Hansen was a fantastic centre-half. A great, great player a long time ago, and a lot of people don't remember him. He was really very good, very classy. No centre-forward can come and obliterate you today like Billy Whitehurst did. He was crazy. It was Boxing Day 1987. He played for Oxford with 9 stitches in his face. He wasn't meant to play, it said in the newspapers, and I was delighted, but he did. 10 minutes to go, winning 2-0. I could hear him growling as we tried to pass the ball across the back four. He had a collision with Bruce Grobbelaar. His stitches burst. The blood went everywhere, and the physio said, it's bad, Billy. You're going to have to come off. And he said, you tried to take me off and I'll fucking kill you. When he was at Oxford, he got offered 2 bare knuckle fights for $1,000 apiece and took them.
Of course he did.
The first was easy, said Billy. I just banged him and he went, easy money. The second one dragged on for a while and I got mauled a bit. I told Morris Evans, the Oxford manager, I'd been in a car accident. He still put me in the team and I had stitches all over my face. And I believe those were the stitches that Alan Hansen was referring to.
Wow.
Neil Ruddock, regularly asked to round up his hardest players by various betting outlets and tabloids, almost as if he's only got one trick.
Good work if you can get it.
Yeah.
I'd do it. He was from Doncaster, Billy White. Big man, scary. I was whacking Brian Dean one game and getting the better of him in one match. And Billy Whitehurst wasn't even playing. So the halftime whistle goes and he runs on the pitch with his suit and tie on and he gets my Southampton shirt and just rips it so I look like I've got a cardigan on with no buttons. And Ruddock had to wear that in the second half with his shorts pulled up like Simon Cowell.
No, no, it's fucking
brilliant. Because they only had one kit.
Brian Dean's a big stick as well.
Yeah.
Apparently, Billy Whitehurst had two party pieces he was known for, one off the pitch, one on the pitch. Which one would you like to know first?
Off the pitch.
Off the pitch, legend has it that after a game, when the team shared a communal bath, he'd wait until most of the players were submerged before opening his bowels.
Fucking hell.
Commanding players to remain where they were as the log bobbed around. And they were all too terrified of him to get out. They'd all be sat there.
Like the Kevin and Perry movie. Yeah,
while shit was just floating towards them.
In a third division bath. Imagine that at some old ground or at Boothby Park, 1984. Billy Whitehurst had 14 pints the night before and just shat in the bath.
And he couldn't have. He just had to just sit there like it wasn't there.
Because you terrified him.
Would he get
he
in
would prefer
well?
To literally eat his shit than fucking upset him.
Would he get in after? Or would he just...
No, he'd be in it.
He'd be in it.
He didn't care. It's his shit.
Yeah. Clean his ass as well.
Clean his ass. His other party piece was on the pitch, and Craig Hignett, who's some older.
Oh yeah,
listeners will remember. Played for Middlesbrough and
Barnsley.
Good player.
Decent
Craig Hignett
player,
was
yeah,
good
yeah.
goal scoring midfielder.
Yeah,
midfielder, second striker. Craig Hignett played and with him at Crewe, and by all accounts, he would look after his teammates as well. Billy Whitehurst.
He'd get that impression.
That he was like, if he'd stand in the tunnel, he'd say, "Anyone fucking comes after you, you tell me, and I'll sort them out." Which we all like, let's be honest.
We all fucking
love to play with someone like that.
Yeah, of course.
Someone like Seb. But he'd say, if you get a chance early on, put the ball up near the penalty spot. Just put it in the air. Don't worry about it being a good cross. Just fucking get it up in the air.
It's different times, isn't it?
And, just put it
up in the air.
Craig Hiddick says, you'd put the ball in, hang it in the air, and you're thinking, where's Billy? Anyway, next minute, you'd see Billy. It's up in the air, and he turns his back towards the goal, and you see him looking over his shoulder, and he's waiting for the keeper to come and punch the ball. And then he'd overhead kick the keeper in the face.
Oh, my God.
So the keeper would get taken off.
Oh, Christ.
Or not come for another cross, which sounds a bit unhinged. Yeah, there was another story about him playing against Nottingham Forest and some stitches burst and he had to come back out with his nose stapled to a hole in his face and play the whole second half, much to the horror of Nottingham Forest's players.
Oh, my God.
The man who couldn't be killed.
When I was reading it, I mean, I feel a bit fucking violated reading all of that out, to be honest, but imagine that. All the top centre-halves of their day and the non-top ones and the shit ones. The whole league.
The whole league, yeah.
The
yeah.
whole three.
Everyone knows it.
The whole four divisions from top to bottom, centre-halves, every 92 clubs are thinking, fucking hell, I don't want to play against Billy Whitehurst.
It reminds me of Sunday League, like when, you know, those players who you dreaded playing and you only have to see them twice a season, but every time you're like, can't be fucked playing Market Drayton today because they've got that cunt up top who's going to elbow me in the face.
Yeah.
It's just like that. And you don't...
And then some.
Yeah, and then some.
I look like I'd been in a car crash from bare-knuckle fighting.
Just to give a sense, you mentioned there about the best defenders, the worst defenders. A great quote that I found...
Oh, Seb, this is good.
Ian Botham.
Beefy.
Beefy obviously played football for Scunthorpe and
Yeovil
Town.
Ian Botham, owner of, as he described it on Twitter, the mighty Beefy sword. Yeah.
Still cannot... One of those things you can never unsee, is it?
Lord Botham.
But he's him and Seb.
Yeovil boys,
aren't they?
Yes.
Yeovil boy.
Yeah.
And he did play for Yeovil for a couple of games.
Yeovil boys, we are here. Shag your women and drink your beer. Yeah. No. Shag your beer and drink your women.
Go around there any day of the week, find Beefy hanging out.
he played for Scunthorpe.
Yeah.
And the reserves played against Hull City and he had a game against Billy. And he didn't, there's nothing specific, but he said the very next day he was flying out with England to play West Indies in the test series.
Fucking
but he said that the Billy Whitehurst was more fearsome than the West Indies attack.
This is the wrong way around. He just says dealing with Billy was easier than the West Indies
attack in those days. Sorry.
I mean, but, that was some West Indies attack.
I mean,
they had
a guy who's nicknamed Whispering Death at that point.
He had to captain England in a test series against the West Indies the day after fucking smashing it. What was both of them doing playing fucking reserve team football, the mad twat?
Yeah, he certainly played for a good month. It was
Say what you want about him, but I respect that.
He played for Yeovil as well, didn't he?
He played. God, there was. I did another fucking 2,000-3,000 on. There's like an ITN news report of it.
it's hard to imagine now, and I know, when were you born, Tom?
1990, yeah.
Ian Botham in the 80s was more famous than any. He was like as famous as Brian Robson.
Yeah, that's what my dad always
said. Probably more, wasn't he?
But I would say those two were like the most famous.
He was the biggest sports star in the country, really, wasn't he? Yeah.
Oh, yeah, he had a Hollywood agent.
Yeah.
100%.
Hollywood agent. It's just awful. He's a fucking bad Tory, isn't it?
I know.
There's some terror.
Who is the toughest player you think you've ever seen, or play for, or has ever seen in the flesh, or
oh, that's
any,
a good question.
Any memories of bruisers?
Pete Wilding, who played for Shrewsbury Town, and he marked Wayne Rooney out the game when they played each other. I was at that game in the FA Cup third round, 2002. Pete Wilding was a semi-pro. He played for, like, you know, Telford and Shropshire teams for many years. And then late in his career, he became a pro for Shrewsbury. And Pete the Feet, everyone called him. He was about 6'3", 6'4".
Pete the Feet! Yeah.
Very skinny, not technically great. Really skinny, but hard as fuck. And he marked a 16-year-old Rooney out of the game.
Did he wallop him as well?
Yeah.
Seb, you must have seen some fucking non-league bruisers in your time.
We had, I don't know if anyone remembers him, John McClelland. Played for Northern Ireland, played for Watford. You remember him, that? But he ended up at Yeovil when he was like 36, 37. And he was, obviously, he was big, but fucking hell, he was solid. And there was, that non-league then as well, it was rough and tumble, and it was just easy for him, just solid. And he could have carried on playing.
Yeah, because non-league now, like, I think people would think if you've not been to much non-league.
But a lot of them now are kids who've been let go by academies for whatever reason, didn't grow at the right time or had a bad season or whatever else. So, to be honest, one good season at non-league, they're fucking...
Exactly. Yeah, there was a guy at West, Carlos Mendes, who got signed by a League One or League Two team.
Fella that plays for... He's playing in the AFCON at the moment.
Yeah,
he played for West?
Yeah, he used to watch him when he was about 17, 18, yeah. And he got snapped up, went up the leagues by quite a lot.
I remember when...
You can't fuck about now and not.
When COVID was on, 9-month run around the world, if there ever was such a thing as COVID.
Yeah, yeah.
Whoa!
It was a plandemic.
The what?
It was a plandemic.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
Seb managed to convince Spotify... And we made an episode of Giant about Hampton and Richmond. And at the time, the club were in a dicey financial state, and you were waiting for the wedge to drop from that player getting sold on.
Jamal Lowe.
That's it, Jamal Lowe.
It was definitely, it was big.
Game-changing money.
Game-changing for two or three seasons.
Yeah. I remember he said, telling me, and he said, this is how it gets spent over the next, this is how much the budget will be a month, and this is how it gets spent.
But John McClellan. Oh,
and then they got rid of the media director for a financial...
embezzling.
Whoa!
Why is this going to the Cayman Islands?
Hey, there's a burgeoning football economy.
Grassroots in the Caymans.
Go on, Asa.
I'm intrigued to know if players,
the
if people
would be
think
like,
about that.
Vidic. Would be a Diego Costa, a Vidic. But like, if we're talking like strikers, it would be like a Diego Costa.
And he's more of a wump.
Yeah,
he is. 100%.
That's what I mean. Yeah.
I think Vidic, you'll remember him, right?
Yeah, he was actually hard. He was hard. But, like, he could also actually play.
Billy Whitehurst scored 24 goals in Division 3 once.
That's because all the goalies...
Billy, you know what? If you're listening, which I hope you're not, fucking fair play.
It's because all the goalies...
We love you, Billy.
I don't have a particular affinity for Pele, but I always like when you interview people and say, he took no fucking shit.
Yeah.
Remember what's his name said?
Tim Vickery always says that.
Pele would get a kick and he fucking wouldn't mind dropping an elbow or a rabbit punch off the board and stuff like that. And I love that about him.
Yeah. Or his teammate. He would defend his teammates, wouldn't he? He got sent off for it and stuff. But
I suppose you don't get to be
in that era.
The best
good in that era without being able to fucking dish it. 100%.
And some of the tackles. So even, I know it's the obvious time, but the 66 stuff that he's getting chopped.
He always used to make me laugh as well. I mean, by no one's idea of a hard man, Robbie Fowler, but he always used to tell Roy Keane to fuck off.
Yeah.
Always. Yeah. He never backed down from him. He'd be like, fuck you, Roy. There's a couple of famous photos of it. He'd be like, go on, fuck off.
Yeah, there is. There is, yes. Yes, there is.
And Shearer, of course, is meant to be genuinely fucking
hard as
handy.
Fuck, yeah.
He'd
have battled Roy Keane.
He looks it.
I disagree.
No, he would.
He'd be a good fight. I'd like to see it.
Roy Keane's all fucking piss and wind. He's shown that now by his...
Specials t-shirt. He is hard. He'd batter me, and I'm hard. For him.
Billy Whitehurst.
Big, bad Billy.
Owen Blackhurst.
I know. There's an affinity there.
Oh, yeah.
Me and Billy.
Oh, God.
On the fucking high seas.
On the high seas. Fuck scurvy. Yeah.
Where are you going,
this
Billy?
This should be good.
It's the West Indies.
We should have...
We're beefy.
The football pirate ship.
Go see a man about Michael Holden.
Where are you going?
Football pirate ship with Captain Blackhurst. Oh, this yeah.
Owen, I'm just going for a swim. I'm going to catch us a dolphin.
Catch us. Great white sandwiches for tea.
Oh.
One of the things to do in football before you die is the flag making, pitch fucking storming, pint sipping, schooner loving, rugby shirt wearing. Big fucking dog, tank driving cunt, Seb White.
Tank man!
Fucking tank man. When I saw that review this morning.
That's fucking brilliant.
I was like, this is the best day of my life. Someone from Australia calls Seb tank man.
I think that's amazing. That genuinely is amazing.
Shut up, love. Tank man's on the fucking radio.
I'm gutted he called me benevolent.
Just get tank man on the back of a t-shirt with Seb in a uniform.
Well, we can go to the tank museum. It's a fucking great. Oh, yeah,
listeners, what you should know is as we're part of a bigger organisation now, there's like channels in the G chat about, and people were being encouraged to share their hobbies. And I'd barbecued a load of Korean spare ribs for my wife and in-laws in the rain. So there was a picture of me under a
bright. That's right. Yeah. It's a good picture that.
So I managed to convince Seb, who'd been to the tank museum that weekend, to put him. He's in fucking shorts. Lent against the tank. I was going, go on, Seb. People have got to know us. I did it quite earnestly.
He did.
And he did it.
I couldn't believe it.
But it was like, obviously, this huge company all around the world, and there's this bloke
in front of a fucking tank.
I like military history.
Yeah, hello, ladies.
If I'm not at a non-league football game, I like military history.
Yeah, we've just
DMs are open.
Yeah, we've...
General inquiries within. Sales.
Look at this panzer.
Sales team all around the world going, we bought this really fucking cool like football lifestyle. Oh, my God. Yeah. who's this?
Tank man
in shorts. What? Unbelievable.
And it's just like he's just tossed it off as well. Like, oh, he likes tank. Fuck it. Tank man. That's the most Australian thing about it as well.
Yeah, you fucking tank man.
Oh, fucking tank man over there. Look at him.
what did he call James? Like a goblin.
But that's James's nickname.
Yeah. He is Goblin Boy.
What was it? The goblin and the what?
The gooser.
The goblin and the gooser. Fancy a pint? Yeah, I see down the goblin and the gooser.
Who's coming? Tank man will be there. Fucking great. I mean,
tank man.
And the benevolent dictator. Oh, no,
he's off the source, mate. 101 things to do in football before you die. Sebastian Dennis White, go.
As suggested by a couple of people, but mainly Nick Robert, who replied to one of our questions on Spotify, was go and watch a game whilst you're on holiday.
Yes.
Let's just stress very clearly here, this is different than going abroad to watch football, like on a weekend or...
Are you saying this because you want Rebecca to keep thinking it's an accident? Oh, would you look at that, Rebecca? Oh, Porto are at home again.
No, but this is why I think it's a thing to do, because there's a number of reasons why I'm a fucking football anorak and I would love something like this anyway, but I actually think there's specific reasons why it's a good thing to do.
A fanorak.
Firstly, it's always quite nice, unless you're going obviously somewhere that isn't on holiday, if you're going on holiday where it isn't warm, but it's actually quite nice to go to a football match in shorts and T-shirts and, you know, depending on how hot it is. But
Or a tank museum.
Yeah, not wrapped up in bloody Gore-Tex.
Yeah.
So I always think that's quite nice, just to go and watch football in the warm. Because even here when it's hot, in obviously pre-season games.
Even here when it's hot, you wrap yourself up in Gore-Tex, don't you?
Well, it doesn't feel right, does it?
Don't trust it.
Do you behave differently when you're watching abroad?
You hope so, because he's a fucking animal in England.
No, but I'm coming on to this, Asad. I'm coming on to this, because I think...
A stain on the game.
If you just... The English disease. Yeah. Yes. Look at him.
Seb off work again. What's he got? English disease.
The English disease. I am coming on to that though, because I think when you go abroad to watch a game, you've obviously got, might have a bit of skin in the game. You might be going with someone that you know, or you might be meeting someone there, and you've planned it, so you're going with people. If it's on holiday, like Owen says, and you go, oh fuck it, there's a third division game in fucking
it's Champions League.
Porto
at the Draga.
You go to it as a complete
neutral.
You go there as a complete neutral, because I think it's hard to watch games, certainly in England. I'll go to a game in England. I'll either know someone or have an affiliation or know a memory of them, thinking, fucking, I never want Stevenage to win. You know, no, we went to Portugal on holiday for a week, and I genuinely didn't even think about it. And then I suddenly went, oh. And this was...
Kind of seems like you did think about it.
This is early noughties. So it's still early days of the internet and not like footballogy apps and all that sort of stuff. Rio Ave were playing Porto. Sporting Lisbon. I'd never fucking heard of Rio Ave before. Never even had a fucking... Obviously knew what Sporting Lisbon were like, but just went along, turned up, you know, rock up. You know, it's a bit different again watching football abroad, isn't it?
What time of day was it? Was it like evening? Morning?
Evening. Lovely. Nice. So, it'd been like 30-odd degrees in the day. Lovely.
Yeah.
You know, a lovely day. You know, a little bit red, a little bit raw from the tan. You got no qualms, and it's just nice, and it's just a nice, relaxing way.
What do you mean you've got no qualms?
Well, you're on holiday.
You're not invested.
No, you're on holiday. So you're on holiday. So if I go to watch fucking the Milan derby, right? I'm sitting there. I'm going there purposely to Milan.
Qualms. That's qualms.
No. But then you go in there.
I've got no qualms.
Football is just a nice distraction, whereas it's not the central thing. And I'm as someone who lives their life a lot to do with football.
Yeah, no, I get it.
It's quite nice just to...
So go on holiday and go to more football.
Yeah.
I'm a bad example, but...
Back in 2016, I ended up with a bunch of my mates. We were in Greece. We went to an Aikia Athens game.
What were you doing in Greece?
Just getting pissed.
Whereabouts?
We were in Athens. We went across the country.
I'm seeing in between as Puss A Patrol.
Yeah, we went in. All I remember of the game, yellow seats, players being a bit shit.
Yeah.
And we're still like steaming out of our asses, basically.
Yeah.
Oh, God.
And we ended up talking to this.
Wonderful image.
We ended up talking to this.
Just asses in the air steaming. On foreign soil.
We ended up talking to this Greek...
Foreign soiled.
To this old Greek guy who didn't know a word of English, but like, it was like April 2016, right?
Right.
All he went was like, Leicester? And we were like, Leicester? And then he was like... Yeah, and then it turns out he was a shirt seller, and he just pulled out a Riyad Mahrez shirt. Just like that.
Oh, class.
And one of my mates bought it.
Nice.
There you are.
Yeah.
100% kosher, I'd imagine, was it?
We just started naming footballers at him, and he was like, yeah, I know these.
The universal language. Did you go to a game?
We're in the stadium.
Oh, fucking hell.
This guy pulled out a Mahrez shirt in the stadium.
In the stadium? Yeah. I thought you were just like,
no,
on
no,
the,
no.
On the
we were just sat. All I remember is just being bent, like, just like doubled over in a chair in the stadium. He's more hungover.
Me and my brother did it once. We went over to Amsterdam to stay with my mate who lives there, and we hadn't checked if there was a game on, just went for a bit of a mad weekend, and there was no Ajax game on, but also on the outskirts of Amsterdam is Almere FC, who were at the time in about 20, it would have been 2018, they were playing PSV. So, you know, like in Spain, where the young PSV.
Yeah, young.
Yeah, in like their equivalent of the championship. Yeah. And Almere now are like, it's a tiny stadium. Yeah. It's like a non-league. It's almost like sort of Telford Stadium. That's what I compare it to. With no corners, probably only two and a half stands. And we just went and stood with all the firm and they embraced us. And but then they're now flying in Eredivisie because you stay in contact with those teams. You sort of watch their progress through the years. And you always have a soft spot for them. Yeah.
It's funny you should mention PSV, because I don't know if it is PSV, but I think their youth team is like their handle or like their Insta bio is like PSV Young Underwild.
Oh, Young Underwild.
It is.
Yeah.
Me and Seb have been to the PSV training ground, of course.
Yeah.
Couple of times, haven't we?
Couple of times.
Couple.
Yeah. They're great people at PSV. Really helpful.
Ruud van Nistelrooy just having a jog behind us.
Yeah. Well, we were interviewing
Boudewijn Zenden.
Boudewijn Zenden, yeah.
Yeah.
And great.
Ruud van Nistelrooy is massive.
Yeah. Is it?
He's fucking massive.
Wow.
It's like someone's taken one of the heads off Mount Rushmore and just stuck it on a big bloke.
Or like an Easter Island.
He was in such good nick.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah.
Oh, it was, yeah, unbelievable. Like, he looked fucking great.
He looked great, didn't he?
Yeah. He was probably 2 or 3 years post-retirement at the time.
I think he might have been in charge of the youth team at the time because then he upgraded to the...
Yeah, he did, yeah.
The first team manager.
Head honcho.
What do you think of him, Rude?
Striker.
Yeah, just,
he was fucking brilliant. I just fucking hated him.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Horse face goal machine, but no, he was brilliant.
Yeah, he was, wasn't he?
I think the best penalty taker I've ever seen. Because every penalty went in that bit.
Yes, yeah, I know exactly which bit you mean. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Bang it in there every time.
Other than against Arsenal.
Other than that one, yeah. Other than that.
But no, I mean, I was watching the other day, but there's this fucking Van Nistelrooy volley when he was playing for Real Madrid, which comes after about a 10-pass, one-touch passing move. It's fucking exceptional.
So Keane said recently, sorry to quote him again, but he said if one striker he played with, if he had to, like, take a penalty to that his life depended on, it would be really
Hard.
He's one of the first footballers I remember because my mum got me a VHS of 03-04 and 04-05 highlights.
Yeah.
And that's when...
VHS then?
Yeah, back in when I was young. God, when I was 8 or 9, because my turn was really into VHS.
You get anything in long sight, mate.
you could, can confirm.
You could get anything in long sight.
Can confirm.
But yeah.
You want that anaconda, Assad?
That's great.
Is it your first match?
My mum's not Marlon Brando.
Hey?
No, don't worry.
Do you want that anaconda?
Introducing The Hattrick, a new subscriber newsletter from Mundial. Each week, there'll be 3 stories linked by a theme. Stories from islands, stories about people, stories about heroes, stories about villains, stories about love, hope, despair, joy, and, of course, goals. Go to mundialmag.com to sign up to The Hattrick now.
The mascots of the world, unite and take over.
It is Assad this week, and he's got a big, big shoes to fill, his own, because Rapid Man, I think, has been the best of the mascots so far, better than Jenny the giraffe, because the sexual undertones with Seb and that giraffe were frankly unsettling. Better than fucking this, you know, better than last week's Bernie the Bear. Fucking hell.
Great boots.
Bernie taking trend, though.
Hardest on working top of bastard, it. Great boots. Goes on European aways.
Multi award winning mascot now. From Seb.
He's got more awards.
I do want to do
Better than Timber Joey.
Juiced up.
I do want to do Frost Nixon, but with Rapid Man. We're going to make that happen.
yes.
Wow. Okay.
This, Asad, this week?
It is you, yeah.
This week, I want to do Hennes, the goat of FC Köln.
The Ooh. Goat as in...
The greatest of all time?
Yeah,
No.
The modern parlance or an actual living goat?
No, he was the Bundesliga's first living actual goat mascot. As in, he is a goat.
Oh,
he's an actual
first
goat.
First living mascot.
Yeah. He's in 1950, a circus director gifted the club, because they didn't have like a lucky charm, gifted the club a goat, and they named it after the guy who was currently player coach, and he was called Hennes.
Nice.
And
I like that.
Just quickly, I don't think I've ever asked this. Where do you stand on circuses?
Ooh,
I enjoy them. I enjoy them.
Read them.
Get out.
No.
Enjoy them. Which one?
I don't mind going to them. I don't mind going to them.
The Russian.
I've hated a few.
We're not talking about Russian state circus and all that jazz.
Yeah.
Not Cirque du Soleil.
Not Cirque du Soleil. Not foreign intelligence.
Which I went to.
You're talking about
the ones that you see posters for in your fucking news agents.
I don't like clowns.
But you do like the animals that have been kept.
That have been
kept servitude.
In, abused.
Kept and abused. Look, yeah. No, I just wanted to get a beat.
I've hated
anyway. back to the goat. Back to Hennes.
Yeah.
Right.
The poor goat. Rescued. Yeah. Clucked.
Yeah. He has remained.
Is he still the mascot?
He's still the mascot, but in different.
Same one.
The right old goat.
No, they're up to the 10th incarnation, but the first one went to.
What do they do when he dies?
They retire him.
Okay.
Yeah. Retire.
And
no, when he's actually dead, what do they do then?
They hold a funeral for him, I think.
They don't cook him.
They don't cook him. Oh. That would be weird.
Would it?
You cook a mascot, and what would you do? Pass it around the first team? Come on.
Honor his life, innit?
Yeah. But he is, he's on the badge. He's on the badge. And he's always on the goat. In. Like before, there was no goat on the badge of FC Köln. He Hennes is the goat that's on.
Oh wow, he's massive. So he's had that much fucking impact.
Mr. Worldwide. Well,
yeah, yeah.
Very regional.
Hennes the Eighth.
yeah. They name him. They name him Hennes the Eighth. We're up to Hennes the Tenth. It's Ajax. 11th.
That's brilliant.
11th.
Hennes the Eighth. He didn't go around fucking beheading his fucking beheading female sheep.
Hennes the Eighth was the most was the most like devious one. Apparently,
was he a shagger?
He'd escape during games. There's a game against like a second division side called VfR Aalen where he escapes during halftime and they have to chase him around the. There's a YouTube video which I included in the running order where he's like bobbing and weaving through past
really?
Cards. Yeah.
Only Hennes the Eighth.
Only Hennes.
Only him.
One of the players tried to ride him. Didn't work out like that. Like they got a saddle and he tried to like get on him.
Well, you'd
didn't
fucking work. Love that, wouldn't you?
I would. Yeah, I would.
Yeah, be all over that. Yeah. Just get a whip, mate.
He's
get a whip. Keep him in a tiny cage.
He used to travel home and away with them, and now he's only home because it's a bit of a faff carrying a goat around in games.
Yeah.
And he's everywhere in the town and like in the with the club. Like he's got coloring books, plushies.
What type of goat is he? Common garden or a mountain goat?
Oh, I love the mountain ones.
I'm not sure. He looks like a mountain goat. He doesn't look like a he looks wild, which is why.
Yeah, I think you're right. Yeah.
He starred in a crime drama.
What? How did you lead with this?
Fuck.
You've been fucking bibbling and bobbing on about fucking
Hennes. I didn't know about this. He's in a TV show. He's in a murder mystery. It's a murder mystery where Hennes the Goat is like in it for like a large part of it.
Oh my God.
3 games into this season, Hennes the Ninth tried to make a break for it again.
Yeah, yeah.
Dragging his handler across the pitch. Go on, Hennes.
Yeah, yeah.
In December 2017, when the team was struggling, they tried to register him to play.
They tried to register him to play, which obviously didn't work. Imagine. There are people who are attached to him. Someone in the... When Hennes the... like
Skinned him. He looks like any other fucking goat.
When Hennes the Eighth died, there was a massive Guardian op-ed written about him by a Cologne fan.
Yeah.
Really?
About how much he meant to the town. Yeah.
Wow.
We're talking of... animals being led on around the pitch like the goat they do on the goat.
They get you with a leash.
No, I've seen pictures of it, but I'd love to be. Well, I mean, they don't do it anymore because I think at Hereford they used to do a fucking full on.
Oh, the cat.
Massive.
The bull.
No,
the
bull.
Bull. Like, sorry,
fucking
yeah.
big.
What's the closest you've ever been bulls. To a bull? I mean, you're from a rural county as well. So
close.
I've been close enough. On a DAV expedition.
Fucking.
Yeah, Jesus fucking Christ.
The size of them compared to a cow.
Yeah.
The muscle.
That's it, isn't it?
It's malignant eyes as well. They want to hurt you.
I went to a rodeo in Arizona, yeah.
It was your first rodeo?
Hey! Right aside, but unlike Assad, I wasn't there to watch animals suffer. I just went to it out of sort of... They arranged it, the tourist board did.
Wow.
And I went right down to the pen.
And... Wow. Just fucking... They must be the biggest ones as well, aren't they?
The noise and the smell and the fucking everything and the tension with the fucking... light. But do you know what they do to make them angry?
Oh, no.
They wrap twine around their bollocks.
Yeah.
You'd book, wouldn't you, if you had twine around your bollocks?
I already do.
Asad had just assumed the position. It's time.
Oh,
milking
man.
Milking season.
Oh, God.
Imagine that. Twine around your knackers. At that same fucking rodeo.
Don't want it.
Yeah.
At that same rodeo, they were strapping kids, like 4 years old, to the back of sheep, wearing helmets, and they were doing sheep racing. There was kids screaming and fucking like, and cowboys going, "Shut up!
Oh my
fucking
god!
Fucking shut up! Get on that fucking sheep, boy!"
This what? America, honestly, fuck you!
Honestly, and then they were doing steer wrestling. So the same cowboy who'd been shouting at his kid, going, "Get on that fucking sheep, boy!" Then went to wrestle a steer and got fucked.
Fuck.
Good.
Oh my
Being
God.
Dragged around in the shit.
If that wants to run amok, that will run amok.
Oh yeah. Yeah. Oh yeah.
And they're just wheeling it around the pitch and I'm thinking, fucking hell.
It's a ticking time bomb.
Walking through a field as a kid wearing a Liverpool shirt.
I've been chased by cows, but not a bull. Yeah.
Why? What were you doing to
just
the cow?
Just the usual Friday night down in Yeovil.
He's milking Daisy again. He's bloody here again. Oh, bloody Longshanks.
No.
I've been chased by cows a few times, but never a bull.
Never a bull. So
what does that say about you?
Yeah, that's an insane thing to say on air.
Next week, I'm going to.
That is insane thing to say on air.
So you'll see me in. Is it Pamplona? Where is that?
Pamplona, yeah. Running the bulls. Yeah.
What do you think of that?
I mean, that's pretty fucking bad, that.
Yeah, it's not a fan.
Yeah, again,
but you like circuses.
I don't like circuses. Yeah. I don't dislike them.
Doesn't like circuses, but doesn't like clowns. So he likes the really bad stuff.
No, I just
trapeze.
I don't have strong feelings against circuses. They're a bit annoying. I don't go to enough circuses. Is what I'm trying to say.
He's tied himself up in knots.
Anyway,
I just don't go to any.
Tying the twine round his nuts here.
Oh.
The Taming of the...
Twined Up in Nuts by Sleaford Mods.
Oh, God, they're boring, aren't they? Cheer up, lads.
Yeah, I know.
Buy some shorts that fit you, mate. You can see massive.
Get a new Bart Simpson t-shirt.
Was that you talking to yourself?
Very good, very good. Fair enough.
Mundial joins the dots for football culture. And that's not a boast by us, but the words of an actual subscriber in our most recent reader survey. Why not see what they're on about and have a look at Mundial magazine? 100 pages of global football magic released 4 times a year. It looks great, smells great, and the writing isn't bad either. Go to mundialmag.com or follow the link in the show description to find out more.
Ins and outs, outs and ins, ins and outs, outs and ins. Asad Raza.
Nice.
In.
One of my New Year's resolutions was to get back into playing instruments, and my mate has a bass guitar, and she's teaching me how to play it. I've only had one lesson so far.
There are two types of bassist in the world.
Yeah.
There are Paul Simonon, and there are John Deacon.
Yes.
And he is a John Deacon. Appear like this. Like Partridge in the Caribbean.
I'm going to come into the office one day with a massive
lessons.
With like Thundercat, and we're going to...
You've been doing it properly, yeah?
I'm seeing you playing a bit of Slap.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, I want to play some Slap bass.
Seinfeld.
And you've never done it before? Team.
You seen Thundercat play Slap bass?
Oh my God, live.
It's incredible.
With his 5-string.
Arouses me, yeah.
Thundercats? What, Lion-O? Mumra's on the bass.
Thundercat's fucking...
Yeah, unbelievable. The best bass player.
He's related to John Coltrane, isn't he?
I believe so, yeah.
And Wiley Cat and Wiley Kit. Learning the bass guitar in. Yeah. I've had a long-held desire to get an acoustic again, but I just haven't got time.
Yeah.
I'm surprised you have, to be honest. We've got a busy job.
You've got to make time.
Might explain. Well, I've only had
What I like about, you know, you're part of the generation, and it's all about life-work balance, and I'm for it.
Yeah.
Thanks, man.
Yeah, yeah.
I am for it. I don't agree with it, but I'm for it. No, that's how it should be. Maybe I'm conditioned to not agree with it.
I'm furious,
I'm not furious. You've got to break free. You enjoy it, man. I'm going to go next. The Brother's Son on Netflix. I mean, I'm ready to give it a go, but Michelle Yeoh is such a fucking badass. Yeah. I thought, I'm going to give it a go.
Yeah.
And if you're looking for something easy to watch with decent fighting, that at times gets a bit cringe, but there's enough about a few of the characters to like. Mm. It's sort of, I felt it ran out of steam a little bit, but especially the first 4 or 5 episodes were good. Then it got a bit telegraphed, but it's a nice thing to watch. Give it a go.
Great.
It's not perfect, but this is the thing. We all search for this.
That could be my Friday night in sort of film.
That's a great point.
We all search for the perfect thing to watch, and it doesn't exist.
Sometimes, yeah.
I agree.
Well, sorry, of choice,
You've got lists about your lists.
Yeah, no, 100%. Exactly, yeah. I've been doing this.
I'm trying to reduce. I've been talking to my therapist about fucking slowly condensing all that down.
It was really worrying. You looked at Seb when you said therapist.
Talking to my therapist.
Got a side. I got myself a side hustle.
Half my wage goes straight to Seb.
There was an advert.
Let me talk about.
Are you mad as well?
Welcome to the club.
Why has he got Welsh? Why is Mad Seb Welsh?
Because he's mad.
Oh my God.
Brilliant. Oh, that's so good.
Not my main hustle, though. That's just my side.
There was, for clarity, there was an advert we saw on the way here that was like, I turned my side hustle into my main hustle. Yeah. And there was someone who, underneath, you had clearly never said the words hustle or side.
Right.
The Brother's Son. I didn't I didn't check its score on IMDb. I didn't then look at what Roger Ebert had to say about it or any of his underlings who are...
He's dead now.
Your Brian Tellericos and stuff like that, carrying on his legacy. I didn't look at any of that. I just went, fuck it, I'll give it a go. And enjoyed it.
Yeah.
Respect.
So, yeah, I'm putting it in because it's my choice. Seb, seems a bit late this, but go on.
Late to the party, but obviously we've talked about my ears being a bit temperamental for a long time. But anyway, I did a Fear of Flying course before I went to Australia, and they said, set yourself up, plan your whole trip and all this sort of stuff. And I thought, I'm sick of listening to things with my headphones on or my bone conductors, and it's shit. So I bought some proper noise-cancelling headphones.
Did you?
Hey.
Which ones?
Well, I say proper, 80 quid on a pair of Sony ones, but over the ear.
Over, not on.
Over, yeah, yeah. Okay. Over the ear, and honestly...
Can't get much for 80 quid, though.
No. But then I didn't know if it was going to work or not, but...
What, the noise cancelling or your ears?
Both. Both, because my ears can get a bit, like, ringy and tinny if I...
Game changer?
Game changer.
Really?
I can't do it all the time. The bone conductors are still very much in the locker. But
in the rotation.
Every now and then when I just want to fucking... And just pressing that button... It's like pure magic. It made a huge difference. And without being like Dom Jolly on Trigger Happy TV when he's walking around with those massive headphones, every now and then when there was a little bit of turbulence, I was like...
That's who you remind me of.
Yeah. Dom Jolly.
What, Jolly?
Just personality-wise, yeah. Anyway, Tommy.
Premier League is when I'm playing a lovely game of chip pan on my own, which I mentioned last week on the podcast, I have really got back into Premier League years. And I realise... Maybe I'm becoming a nostalgia fan as someone who goes to every home Man United game. But it's just really nice. It's really comfortable. And it can be any season, even a league season where Arsenal won it or whatever. It's just, it's very soothing, I find. Washes over you.
Yeah. No, it's very good.
It's well packaged, isn't it? It's just nice to watch.
It's fun.
It's easy. It's very easy. I like, you know when they do the news?
Not as good as the Wonder Years.
No. You've always said that. God,
yeah.
No.
And he has always said that.
Specific.
My out is hoarding stuff that I'll never use. Or like...
Yeah, man.
I feel your pain here.
Yeah. Same.
Like, and I've started doing it again and I just seemingly can't control it. But when I was moving out of my old flat, I had to give away, I think, about 80 books to charity.
Yeah.
Like books,
dollars.
Yeah. I went to a charity shop and bought a few more things. I've got like 8 or 9 jackets.
I've seen your dressing up box under your bed.
Yeah, and surplus. I've got so many clothes.
He's got a wicked dressing up box.
No, I've got so many clothes. I've got so many clothes that my girlfriend, I've got a box for her, which she can put her clothes in. Yeah. I've got an extra box for all the magazines that I have because I get like some weekly magazine subscriptions and stuff.
Journalist, innit?
Yeah. Although the Monday Owls are on my desk. Yeah.
What is it Chris Finch says in The Office? Yeah. I read a book a week, so.
I'm with you on this because...
Body students.
Do you know what? Hoarding, out.
Yeah.
But we segue straight into mine because I've got shit everywhere. Right? I fucking gave a load of... And it's losing things. Losing things I need is bad.
Yeah.
Right? And it's fucking... It's an ADHD thing and fucking hell is it... Like,
Does it drive you...
Because it's always when I've got too much going on.
Yes. Yeah.
I've lost my fucking great beanie. I can't find the fucker and I'm fuming about it. But today when I was going out, I was like, oh, nice wintry sunny day. I'll just grab my sunglasses. No. I got 2 pairs of Ray-Bans in the house, 1 fucking prescription, 1 non-prescription. With the lenses they conned me into, that's about 500 quid's worth of sunglasses. Can't find either of them. My missus was like, we need to get you a mess table. And I went, oh. Fucking tragic is that? And for her to say that, a tidy person who hates mess, it shows what a kind person she is. She was like, we'll get you a mess table. And I was like, no, because then Zach will have to have one because unfortunately he's as messy. And I was like, but yeah, I get it.
I can relate to both, like massively. It's an ADHD thing. And that feeling of loss when you lose it as well.
But it's the same shit all the time. Oh, headphones. Where's my headphones? Why aren't they in the same
place? Well, I lost...
I do that with my phone and my glasses all the time.
Oh, glasses.
I forget where I put them.
Losing stuff, out. Hoarding, out. Seb, this seems like a very personal attack, but let's go with it.
A personal attack. I've got personal beef with Carl Robinson from back in the day when he was manager of Franchise FC and was giving it all the big and saying that Yeovil weren't going to get promoted, and we fucking did. Saw him outside Wembley after we'd got promoted and gave him a few dismissive words. Not in an aggressive way.
Are you going to pull
Actually,
up?
It was quite aggressive.
What did you say?
Huh?
What did you say?
Come on.
Come on.
Verbatim, please.
I said, what did I say to Carl Robinson on the way out after we'd just been promoted to the championship?
Yes. Yeah.
When they'd lost in the playoffs. Because
You've set the scene. What did you say? Yeah. You've set the scene twice now. What did you say?
I think I did say, have that, you franchise cunt. Anyway.
Game on.
Would you... He's back in football.
He's back in football.
Manager. And he got sent off within 15 minutes of his first game. I think that tells you everything you need to know about the man.
Yeah.
Where's he managing, Seb?
Fucking Class of 92.
Oh, FC United of Manchester.
Class of 92 Wankathon.
Yeah. Hey, I actually agree with that.
Yeah, another manager.
Gary, if you're looking for a Gary full-time podcast producer with the club, get me. Can Keno come? Can you get Keno, right? He's dead on.
Don't forget, this is a man who wrote a book about how to save English football. He wrote a book about how to save English football, and he's there fucking juicing this non-league club up for three seasons and just sacking managers left, right and centre and then going, oh, there's too much short-termism in football. What's fucking...
Would you...
Carl Robinson is out and so is Seb, by the sounds of it. So, Tommy.
My out this week is the iPhone sound level warning thing. What, like, how the fuck do you stop that? Like,
you can't. You can't.
It's irritating. Like, I sound a bit like Roy Keane then.
You really did. Yeah.
Come on, man. It's irritating. Come on.
Yeah, you're fucking smiling. You're fucking parties. Parties.
See out there.
Who wants a fucking party?
In the word of Roy Keane, it's their job. To tell you when
for people like you,
too loud.
Yeah, for people like you who have fucked ears. But my ears, even though I've been in bands for years, and
you're not getting any credit for that, Apple. It's their job.
Come on, Apple. Come on, that's not good enough.
I'm
come
not giving
on.
You credit for kicking the ball.
Gary, come on.
You're sliding into patois now.
Parties.
Gotta stop it.
Anyway, iPhone sound level one. It's just fucking annoying. Man.
Off they go. Yeah. Off they go. Out. This has been reminding you why you love football. Is it exhausting for you? We are Mundial. Magazines out. Podcasts share. Do it all. We want to carry on doing this. This is generally the highlight of our weeks.
Yeah, man.
Love doing it. Love the reception it's getting. Love the fact it's growing every week. The listenership still seems to be going up. So if you're sharing it and referring it to people and leaving reviews and doing all the things that help podcasts grow organically, because we haven't got a big name attached to this. You know, we're not one of those celebrity-led shows that can instantly drop in at the top of the charts because of their, you know, big name hosts. So this has really got to grow organically, like we did originally with the magazine. So it does mean a lot, and we enjoy it. And if we ever veer off and get too self-congratulatory, or it feels like an in-joke, then please do tell us. But hopefully it's still a place you enjoy being. And there was another review I read recently which said, once I turn it on, I feel like I walk straight into the studio with the lads.
Ah, class. I promise I'd give him a shout-out, because he said it would mean the world. Tony, who I saw in Cask in Manchester recently.
We've had some nights in Cask, haven't we, Seb?
Yeah.
Have you?
Yeah.
An IRL fan of the pod who said, by the way, he was handing over the darts arrows to me, and he said...
You made him give up the dartboard.
You've been on there for fucking 2 hours. Yeah. We were waiting. It was my mate's birthday, and I was like... And then he saw me. He was like, oh, yeah, go on. Honestly. But shout out to Tony. Legend. Lovely guy. Nice people coming up to you in the flesh and loving
this
the
keeps
podcast.
Happening to you lot. I haven't had this happen to me once. Yeah, seriously. No, it hasn't.
So if you see Owen.
I'm not really anyone DM me about it, and I'm fine with it, but I like...
I live out loud, though, don't I? And I'm single and desperate.
This has been Remind You Why You Love Football. Thank you very much. See you next week.
Bye.
See you. Reminding You Why You Love Football is a Mundial and Football co-production. Produced by Tommy Stewart and Seb White, hosted by me, Owen Blackhurst, and recorded on the run.